Okay, so let me begin the afternoon session of Thursday. So the first speaker is Peter Serent, probably I mispronounced his name, from ICFO. He'll be talking about some new diagonalization methods, which is applicable to non-equilibrium phenomena. So please, yeah, begin.
Thank you for the introduction, and I would like to thank the organizers for this invitation to this nice workshop. Yes, my name is Peter Serent. I am currently postdoc at ICFO, and my today's talk is going to be about PolFET, which is abbreviation for polynomially filtered exact diagonalization. And I will try to argue that this approach is useful in studies of non-equilibrium phenomena in quantum many body systems. So as a motivation to calculate highly excited eigenstates, which is the aim of this of the PolFET algorithm, I would like to mention the eigenstate thermalization hypothesis and its studies, which started since the 90s. And as it is already apparent from Fabian's talk, calculation of eigenvectors in the middle of spectra of many-body Hamiltonians is the way to probe whether system obeys eigenstate thermalization hypothesis or maybe not. And if it doesn't obey, then we are speaking about various forms of ergodicity breaking, weak forms as quantum many-body scars or Hilbert space fragmentation, or stronger forms such as and more robust such as many-body localization, which recently has been the subject of quite intense debate about the role of finite size effects and their eventual meaning for the many-body localization phenomenon. In all of those topics, one needs to calculate highly excited eigenstates, eigenstates in the middle of the spectrum of many-body Hamiltonian in order to get some insight about the system. So as a model Hamiltonian, let me bring up the standard model of many-body localization, which is XXZ Heisenberg spin chain, which is a spin 1/2 model. In the context of my studies of my talk, we considered on a single of one-dimensional lattice, coupling between neighboring spins and disordered on-site magnetic field. If one looks at the Hamiltonian matrix of this model, one immediately sees that it is a many-body quantum many-body system, so the Hilbert space dimension is exponential in the system size because of the conservation of total SZ. The Hilbert space dimension is not 2 to the L, but slightly smaller, but still exponential in the system size. One of the features of this matrix is that it is sparse in the eigenbasis of SZ operators, because the spin flip term spin configurations which differ by a single spin, which means that each spin configuration is coupled at most to L other spin configurations. And this structure is probably the structure we would like to exploit in order to reach as high as possible system sizes in diagonalization studies of such models in order to get the best understanding of the limit of large system sizes in the considered problems. So a lot of condensed matter problems deal with the ground state and few lowly lying excited states of the model. And in those cases, the Lanczos algorithm is one algorithm which allows to calculate the lowly lying excited state, lowly lying eigenstates of the Hamiltonian. It is known from 90s. I will be interested in its block version, which was outlined in this reference, for instance. However, the the details of the procedure are not so important. The important fact is that this is an iterative method which allows to obtain exterior eigenpairs of sparse matrices in an efficient way. And the basic idea is that the algorithm performs an iteration which forms a basis of Krylov space starting from certain initial vector. And then since this Krylov space has vectors which are formed in such a way that there are multiple actions of the Hamiltonian on certain initial vector, the eigenvectors of the components of the eigenvectors which are dominating in the spectrum of Hamiltonian are are magnified, which means that the and that's why the this method, when one calculates the Hamiltonian matrix in this Krylov basis, the eigenvectors of this basis after rotation converge to eigenvectors of the Hamiltonian to dominant eigenvalues. And the Lanczos algorithm will be the basic algorithm which I will use in my studies. However, it is efficient only for the exterior, meaning the smaller exterior eigenpairs, meaning eigenpairs to smallest and largest eigenvalues of the system. And if one wants to go to the middle of the spectrum, one needs to find another scheme. And spectral transformations and spectral filtering is the way to go in such situation, such situations. The idea, for instance, of the shift and invert method, which I will call CMET, is to perform a transformation of the Hamiltonian matrix to a certain other matrix, which has the property that which has the same eigenvectors as the original matrix, but the eigenvectors corresponding to the eigenvalues in the middle of the spectrum of the of the initial Hamiltonian become exterior eigenvalues of the transform matrix. And this is, for instance, achieved by shift and invert spectral transformation. As shown on this plot, the eigenvalues in the middle of the spectrum become the lowest and highest eigenvalues of the transform matrix. However, one drawback of this transformation is that in order to perform a Lanczos iteration, which we want to do for the transform matrix, we need to act with the inverse of the shifted Hamiltonian. One way to do that is to perform LU decomposition of the Hamiltonian. However, this doesn't preserve the sparse structure of the Hamiltonian matrix, leading to severe filling of the matrix, which was identified as a main bottleneck of the method, as it requires very large amounts of RAM memory when doing calculations for many body systems at large system sizes. Despite that, this shift and invert method allowed to reach system sizes in this for this XZ spin chain of about 24 spin chains, which is the still close to the current state of the art. In order to circumvent the problem of the shift and invert method, I would like to consider polynomial spectral transformation, which is basis of the Polfed algorithm, which has the same idea. We perform a certain transformation of the Hamiltonian matrix, but this time we consider a high order polynomial of the Hamiltonian matrix, such that it is very strongly peaked around certain values, certain eigenvalues in the middle of the spectrum of the initial Hamiltonian. But still, this is a polynomial of the Hamiltonian, which means that if we want to calculate action of such transformed matrix on the vectors, this action reduces to multiple matrix vector multiplications and linear algebra operations, which means that it can be done efficiently without with preserving the sparse structure of the Hamiltonian matrix. In the particular implementation of the Pohlfeld method, I have used expansion of Dirac delta function around energy target sigma into Chebyshev polynomials, which can be done if one rescales the spectrum of the Hamiltonian to interval from -1 to 1 on which the Chebyshev polynomials are orthonormal functions.
May I ask a question?
Yes, please.
So in the case of sigma, there are bisection between epsilon and R sigma epsilon. But in the case of a polynomial transformation, it's not bisection. Does that become a problem or not?
Could you speak a little bit louder? Because I can very barely hear you.
Sorry.
Do you hear me now?
Oh, yeah. Now I hear you.
Okay. So in the case of sim 8, the correspondence between epsilon and R sigma epsilon is 1 to 1. That's bisection.
That's true. Yes.
But in the case of polynomial transformation, it's not bisection.
True.
So
true.
Does that become a problem? For example, if you want to obtain eigenvalue and eigenvector near epsilon equals 0, but positive epsilon, but P0 epsilon close to 1.0 can correspond to epsilon negative.
Yes, that's true. So the idea is to calculate small fraction of eigenvalues and eigenvectors in the middle of the spectrum. And I will argue very soon that the eigenpairs to which the Pohlfeld converges are the ones which are in this shaded area. So once we so only above the certain threshold value of this polynomial lie the eigenpairs to which the method converges, and it won't converge to or it will converge in very bad manner to eigenvalues which are outside this shaded interval. So probably it will be also clearer when I go to more details about the method. But thank you for the question. So I would like to note that the ideas of using polynomial spectral filtering were already there in slightly different contexts for some time.
Yeah. Can I ask a question?
Yes, please.
So here, is there some reason why you choose the Chebyshev polynomial?
So I would like to construct. Only that the properties of Chebyshev polynomials are nice and that they form orthogonal bases on the -1, 1 interval. But I could use any type of polynomial of high order of the polynomial of the Hamiltonian matrix, which has the property that is very strongly peaked around certain energy, and otherwise in this over the rest of the spectrum of the Hamiltonian it is small, and that's the requirement for the filter polynomial. If it has this property, then it is good. And in this particular implementation, I use this, and I also use the fact that one can calculate that such sums of Chebyshev polynomials in a nice way using slightly smaller number of algebraic operations. But still, the most important factor is the number of the times you need to multiply your vector with the Hamiltonian, which is determined by the order of the polynomial K, which I will describe how to set it.
I have another question somehow which came out after hearing Masaki's comment. I mean, even though we stay in the shaded region, as you said, and I find a certain, let's say, orange dot, how can I distinguish if that orange dot initially was corresponding to, let's say, plus epsilon or minus epsilon? I mean, the function is symmetric, right, around that. So I I'm not confused.
Yes. So once your algorithm converges to eigenvector, the eigenvector is both eigenvector of the polynomial of this polynomial as well of your matrix. So what you do?
I see.
On this on the eigenvector corresponding to dot, and you get the energy. And this is also the way how you check that the eigenvector is well converged.
I see. So essentially, you say you read the eigenvector, the eigenvalue at the end. I mean, you find the eigenvector and then you find the eigenvalue from the original matrix from H.
Yes. Okay, thanks.
Yeah, sorry. Sorry, Piotr. One more question. Could you go? Yeah. So first, I would like to make a comment. I guess one reason why Chebyshev polynomials are used so widely, is that they provide the expansion over the Chebyshev polynomials has nice properties like uniform convergence, which I'm not sure other polynomials give you. But I have another question. So why choose specifically delta function? Because for example, you could play the same game with the expansion over the polynomials with the inverse. And at least at least one benefit that I can see of still sticking with the inverse is that if you're looking for an eigenstate somewhere with the high density of states, the inverse would blow up the gaps. So it will be much easier to isolate the states that you want.
Yes, yeah, very good question. But the thing is that you, in order to have as good properties in the convergence of the method, as good efficiency as you can get, you need to have the polynomial to be as sharp, to have as sharp maximum as possible. In that way, the gaps in the shaded region will be blown up. And then the question is how well, with a given order of the polynomial, you can approximate either delta function or inverse. And then the order of the polynomial is the number of the multiplications of the Hamiltonian on vectors you need to perform in order to make a step of Lanczos iteration. And then this is what I found optimal. If one considers this expansion of the Dirac delta, then I got the best efficiency. I could also try to approximate, let's say, this inverse with polynomial, but if I set fix certain order of the polynomial, then it will have this it will try to approximate this discontinuity which is there, and then it won't give me as sharp maximum with a given order of the polynomial which I want to optimize.
Okay, thanks.
All right. So let me go to further details about the Polfield algorithm. So first of all, in order to use the Chebyshev polynomial, we need to rescale the Hamiltonian so that its spectrum lies between -1 and 1. And to that end, one needs to calculate the maximal and minimal eigenvalue of the Hamiltonian, which is easy task compared to the calculation of eigenvalues in the middle of the spectrum and can be done with the ordinary Lanczos iteration for the initial Hamiltonian. And then one calculates the order of the polynomial spectral transformation using the density of states. If the Hamiltonian H is a sparse matrix, then there are efficient methods to calculate the density of states. And using the density of states of the Hamiltonian, knowing what's the number of the requested eigenvalues you would like to find in the middle of the spectrum of the Hamiltonian, we compare those two things tune the order of this polynomial in such a way that the eigenvalues in the shaded area, that the number of the eigenvalues in the shaded area is the number of the eigenvalues which we are requesting in our calculation. and I am considering specifically targets sigma equal to zero, but I could also consider different targets, different energy targets in the going to higher or smaller energies. And once one has this order of the transformation determined, one performs block Lanczos iteration for this high order polynomial of the matrix H, choosing block size and starting for some from some random vectors. After m steps of the Lanczos iterations of the block Lanczos iteration, one gets the matrix Tm, which one diagonalizes. This is a small block tree diagonal matrix, and the eigen pairs of this matrix can be used to obtain the eigenvalues of the initial Hamiltonian. Since this is a Lanczos iteration during the loop, I can very easily say what's the residual error which is associated with the with a Krylov space of given size, and I use it to monitor the convergence during the iteration. And what is found is that the method does not converge as a number of steps. So this is for s equal to one, and this is the number of the performed steps and the number of eigenvalues which are converged is shown on the vertical scale. So what is found is that different plots correspond to different numbers of requested number of eigenvalue, which is shown by the dashed line. So what is found is that the convergence starts quite rapidly, and only once the basis of the vectors which span the space corresponding to the eigenvalues in this shaded region is well found by the Lanczos iteration, only then the convergence occurs, and then the method converges. One nice feature of this algorithm is that if one increases the number of requested eigenvalues for given density of states, this translates into decreasing the order of the transformation, which means that if I increase the number of requested eigenvalues by two, I decrease, roughly speaking, the order of the Hamiltonian by two, because then the shaded area can be twice larger, which means I don't need such broad such narrow maximum. I need it to be twice broader, which means that I can I perform the same. The number of steps is also twice larger, so it means that roughly speaking, modulo the reorthogonization costs which are there in the loop, I can increase the number of eigenvalues to which the algorithm converges without significantly increasing the runtime of the algorithm. This of course ceases to be true once the reorthogonization costs which are there in the Lanczos iteration start to be significant. But given that the fact that this order of the polynomials can be of order of 1,000 or few thousand, this allows me to calculate thousands of eigenvalues in the middle of the spectrum of sparse matrices which have sizes of million or slightly larger. So the features of this method are the following. First of all, the main time-consuming task is the calculation of the action of this high order polynomial of the matrix on vectors.
Sorry. I have a question.
Yes.
Can you repeat the definition of can you go back to the previous slide? Can you repeat the definition of the y-axis in the lower panel? Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. So this is the number of eigenvalues which are converged two eigenvalues of the Hamiltonian H, by converge I mean that action of the Hamiltonian on corresponding eigenvector minus the average value of the Hamiltonian times this vector, the norm of such a vector is smaller than certain epsilon, which is 10 to minus 14. Let's say.
By checking that, you are guaranteed to have eigenvalues of the Hamiltonian.
I am checking that, if the gaps in the Hamiltonian aren't smaller than the epsilon which I am using as my criterion, then I am then they are numerically the converged eigenvectors.
But then my question is that in the middle of the spectrum, usually the nearby gap is really small, so that
yes.
What you wind up having is the superposition of those nearby eigenstate rather than like the eigenstate of the Hamiltonian. Can you resolve
yes, that? Yeah. So in order to be sure that this is not the case, so first of all, if I have exponentially large matrix, then the gap in the middle of the spectrum is exponentially small. But this is much like the largest matrix sizes I can get to are still much. Much smaller than the inverse of the numerical precision I can get. So I take the vector which I have calculated, or the set of the vectors I have calculated. I act with the Hamiltonian on them, and I calculate the residuals which I have just explained. So and if I know that the difference between action of the Hamiltonian times the vector minus the average value of the Hamiltonian in that vector. If I calculate such a vector, I take its norm, and if it is smaller than the significantly smaller than the gap in the middle of the spectrum, then I know that I have good eigenvectors calculated. So and this is what I'm doing, and this is how I am finally checking the quality of the obtained eigenvalues and eigenvectors.
Yeah, thanks.
All right. So the dominating cost in the Polfeld algorithm is the action of this high order polynomial. It can be parallelized in two ways. First of all, by introducing this block Lanczos method, in which instead of acting just with the high order polynomial on just single vector, I'm acting on a block of vectors. And I can use, let's say, 24 or 48 vectors in a block, which allows me, and then I can calculate action of the of this high order polynomial on each of them separately. And also one could think about And this is actually the only parallelization which is done in my code of the Polfed. But one could also try to think about ways of parallelizing the individual sparse matrix times vector products. The memory consumption is dominated by the matrix of the which is created during the Lanczos iteration, which stores the vectors which are it stores the initial vector and the vectors which are obtained by action of this high order polynomial of the Hamiltonian on the initial vector, and this is the dominating memory consumptions. And since the number of steps of the Lanczos iteration, if one chooses the fixes the order of the polynomial as I have described, is such that the number of steps is two or three times larger than the number of than the memory needed to store the requested eigenvectors. This describes the cost of the method, which is just slightly larger than the memory cost needed to store the calculated eigenvectors. Another feature of the Polfed is that its time consumption increases only linearly with increasing number of the non-zero elements of this Hamiltonian, because this is how the sparse matrix times time vector multiplication scales. And this is not the case for the shift and invert method, in which this increase is much more abrupt. And I will show some benchmark very soon. But it's also important that if one reverses it and considers matrix with smaller and smaller number of non-zero elements, at some point shift and invert method will be much more efficient. And this is, for instance, what I found for Anderson model on random graphs with quite small number of with quite random graphs with a small degree vertex. And in that case, shift and invert method was much more efficient. But if we consider typical many-body systems in which we have at least of the order L sites to, states to which the each basis vector is coupled to, then Polfed performs as follows. So I am showing benchmark for XXZ and J1, J2 models. So J1, J2 model is modification of this XXZ model with additional next to nearest neighbor couplings. which from the point of view of the Hamiltonian just increase the number of non-zero elements in this in the Hamiltonian. And I am showing the CPU time versus the matrix size, as well as the memory consumption versus the matrix size. So what is shown for XXZ is that I would say that the times CPU, total CPU times needed by Polfed and Schiffer-Nieverth method are quite similar. However, the memory consumption is orders of magnitude smaller for Polfed, especially as one goes to larger system sizes. This dot corresponds to 24 and this dot corresponds to 26 sites. So Fabian was saying that for 26 sites, the memory consumption for XXZ model with Schiffer-Nieverth method is unrealistic, and it is of the order of 10 to 5 gigabytes, which means that the calculations need to be performed on roughly 10,000 cores of 10,000 nodes of a supercomputer, whereas memory consumption for Schiffer-Nieverth method is smaller than of the order of few hundred of gigabytes. If one tries to calculate few thousand of eigenvalues in the middle of this matrix for 26 pins, but it's also important to note that the total CPU time is quite similar, which means that when I was calculating this point, I needed to take roughly 30 days on a single node, whereas the Schiffer-Nieverth calculation, if it is based on massively parallelized LU decomposition, then it takes less than an hour on those 1,000 nodes of a supercomputer. When one increases the number of non-zero coefficients, then the memory consumption gets of the Schiffer-Nieverth method gets even worse, and then already for 22 sites, it's quite hard to calculate things with Schiffer-Nieverth method. One requires few terabytes of RAM memory, whereas the memory usage of Polfed for this model and for this model is roughly the same. And the time used for calculations has increased only by a factor of roughly two. In contrast to Schiffer-Nieverth method, for which the curve for the CPU time was pushed significantly up. Another feature of the polynomial filtered diagonalization idea is that it can be used to flock at unitary operators. So
I have a question yes? In comparing of the two methods. So how about the precision or numerical error? Maybe are they also same? I mean,
so both algorithms are converging to eigenvectors to numerical precision, meaning that the residual norm, which I was mentioning before, is of the order of numerical precision. So this is what needs to be done in order, what is achieved by the two algorithms. Actually, I'm not sure whether this point was calculated in double or single precision, but regardless of whether it was double or single precision, the two methods are calculating, both Schiffer-Nieverth and Polfed are calculating eigenvectors with the residual norms of the order of the numerical precision. instead of sparse Hamiltonian matrix, we may have a flocked operator, which is constructed in such a way that it is a product of two or few exponentials of certain local Hamiltonians. Such flocked operators arise, for example, in kicked models, which were considered in quite early in those works. And if one has a flocked operator, the total flocked operator as a matrix after the multiplication of those two exponentials may be a dense matrix, which means that the Schiffer-Nieverth method can be used to it very, taking into account that it is a full dense matrix. However, if those Hamiltonians are local, then there might be a way of acting efficiently with the with this flocked operator on vectors from the Hilbert space. And I will show later on an example for a kit Ising model. And if those Hamiltonians are local, then it is guaranteed that there is a efficient way of acting with flocked operator on vectors from Hilbert space. If we have a flocked operator, it is a unitary operator rather than a Hermitian or real symmetric matrix, which means that spectrum of it is on unit circle on complex plane. And in that case, one can make the same, play the same game, but changing the polynomial which we are using, namely, consider a higher order, again, higher order polynomial of this flocked operator, but this time in the form of a geometric sum. And such a geometric sum makes a similar thing as the high order polynomial I described before, namely, it magnifies the modulus of the eigenvalues which are close to the energy target, denoted by red, and keeps rest of the eigenvalues with a certain bounded module. In that way, if we perform Lanczos iteration or Arnold iteration in that case, for this high order polynomial of the flocked operator, it will converge to eigenvectors which correspond to eigenphases close to the chosen target eigenphase. And it is actually even easier to do for the flocked operators, because we know that for flocked operators, the spectral density is constant, which means that it is easy to choose the order of the polynomial, which scales with the proportionality to the dimension of Hilbert space, divided by the number of eigenvalues with some factor which is of the order 1 or 1.5, and it can be optimized so that the we get the requested number of eigenvalues as efficiently as we can. And this is benchmark from this paper by David Lewis, which proposed this idea to tackle the flocked operator eigenvalue problem. And with the geometric sum filtering, one can go to system sizes of the order of 20, which significantly increases the spectrum of the system sizes available for exact calculation of eigenvectors. For instance, full exact diagonalization is roughly available nowadays for up to 16 sites. Whereas this L equal to 20 in geometric sum filtering can be pushed forward. And by the way, the residues, which I have described are provided here. So this is the maximal residue for the calculated eigenvector. So it is always of the order of 10 to minus 15, comparable or even smaller than the ones obtained in the full exact diagonalization, which is a kind of a nice property, given the fact that we are using a high order polynomial of the flocked operator. So one could think that if we are using a polynomial of the order of 1,000, let's say we have Hilbert space dimension 1,000,000 and we have 1,000 eigenvalues, then one could think that there should be a certain loss of precision, and it turns out not to be the case. I do not fully understand why this works so well, but it does, and this is confirmed by independent study by David Lewis as well. As I have argued, the main bottleneck of the Polfet method and in general the polynomially filtered approaches is the speed of the multiplication of the vectors by the matrix you are having. And one of the questions for the future is whether one could use architectures different than CPU in order to speed up the Polfet. And recently I have heard a talk about TPUs, which are tensor processing units. And I will be also interested in your opinion, because I know that they have been developed in order to act for users with neural networks. And their architecture allowed to multiply matrices very quickly, and they are designed specifically towards this end. So maybe such architectures or GPUs could be used in order to speed up PolFET and get larger system sizes. And this is a comparison of the number of the seconds per iteration of one flocked operator taken from this work. And it compares CPU to GPU, as well as to those tensor processing units built into larger and larger blocks. And we see a significant speed up, which could increase the number of the qubits accessible in PolFET approaches, since this is the main bottleneck. The other calculations in this diagonalization are steps of calculation are not taking so much time. Okay, so this brings me to end of the part of my talk about PolFET. If there are no questions specifically to the PolFET, I could follow to the part about many body localization. All right. So as a one system to which PolFET can be used, I am considering the J1, J2 model. I am considering the problem of many body localization. So I have this disorder in the system, and I am calculating eigenvectors and eigenvalues in the middle of the spectrum. In particular, I am concentrating on the gap ratio, which is a certain probe, which is calculated using just the eigenvalues. And it for small values of disorder, it reaches the value characteristic for random matrix ensemble of Gaussian orthogonal matrices, whereas for large values of disorder, it approaches value characteristic for Poissonian ensemble of non-interacting uncorrelated energy levels. The crossover between the two regimes is quite broad. The question is, where is the many-body localization transition, and if there is many-body localization transition at all? So there is a significant flow of the crossing point as we increase system size, and this is not what one could hope for. For instance, in measurement in space transition, which is a different problem, we have a very nice crossing point at certain value. This is not the case for this many body localization problem. And to that end, I am introducing two disorder strengths in order to analyze this crossover between the ergodic and localized behavior. Namely, I am considering WT, which is a disorder strength for the deviation from the ergodic value up to certain epsilon value, to certain threshold, which I take as which is certain small number. And I'm also looking at the crossing point as a function of system size. And those two disorder strengths, in some sense, divide the finite size phase diagram of the model in three regions. The disorder strengths smaller than the WT are evidently in the ergodic regime, above WT but below W star. We have the property that every probe is increasing with system size, so we have a critical region in which there is flow towards ergodic behavior. And above a critical point, if it's at certain point stops to move, we will have the many-body localized phase. And if one looks at those two disorder strengths as a function of system size, one finds two incompatible mappings, both for J1, J2, incompatible scalings, pardon, both for J1, J2 model as well as for XXZ models. Namely, one finds that the WT, which describes the deviation from the thermal behavior, scales with good approximation linearly with the system size, as those gray dots show. Whereas the crossing points scale with good approximation as 1/L in system size. This scaling, this 1/L scaling, if extrapolated to infinite system size, would result in certain critical disorder strengths. strength. However, and this critical disorder strength is quite larger than the one which is which can be obtained from straightforward finite size scaling, which is roughly 4. If one does this extrapolation for XXZ spin chain, one gets 5.4 rather than 4. And 4 is roughly the position of the last crossing for the larger system sizes available. However, since the two scalings are incompatible, one cannot really decide what is happening for those models. The two scalings cross roughly at system size 50. However, we cannot reach such large system sizes presently, so we don't know which one of them will break down. And if it turns out that the scaling of the crossing point breaks down and starts to follow the scaling of this WT, then we would end up with having no MBL phase in the thermodynamic limit. Those observations motivated us to consider many-body localization problem in constrained spin chains. Constrained spin chains can be, for instance, obtained in experiments with Rydberg atoms in Rydberg blockade regime, where strong interactions prevent two spin-up states to be in two neighboring sites. They must be separated at least by certain number of sites, which is in here I'm taking this radius of the blockade as alpha as a parameter of the model, and I'm considering the model describing such Rydberg atoms with disorder. For radius of the blockade alpha and without disorder, this is the famous PXP model which hosts many body quantum scars. And the nice feature of this model is that the Hilbert space dimension is not scaling as 2 to the L, but certain number which is smaller than 2 to the L due to this blockade. And with increasing blockade radius, one can get larger and larger system sizes. This is also, which means that the Hilbert space dimension scaling is slightly more favorable for exact diagonalization studies. This feature was employed also by Fabian Allet in his works on dimer problems in 2D. And when we have examined the crossover between the ergodic and localized regions in those models, we found that at larger system as we get to larger and larger system sizes and larger and larger radius of blockade, we always see a linear drift of both disorder strengths, which suggests slow delocalization of those models. So it suggests that so if one compares it to the behavior for the XXZ spin chain, we see that in those models the behavior of the WT is the one which then influences the behavior of the crossing point, and all crossover between the ergodic and localized region shifts to larger and larger disorder strengths, meaning that there is probably no many-body localized phase in thermodynamic limit because everything shifts to infinite disorder strengths. This is of course very, very, very distant extrapolation. But this is what is suggested by those finite size system studies. We also considered another problem of constrained spin chains in which the fermions can hop between sites of a one-dimensional lattice, but still are subjected to this Rydberg blockade constraint, and they are subject to disorder. And we also found that the crossover between ergodic and many-body localized regimes shifts towards larger and larger disorder strengths as we increase system size. When we found those numerical results, we realized that there is a certain interplay between the constraints in those models and the disorder. Namely, this model, in absence of the disorder, is just can be mapped to a non-interacting problem. Associating each of the particles with certain radius and then hopping on a one-dimensional lattice as a free particles. However, once one introduces the disorder, this problem becomes interacting, which means that the disorder is also a source of interactions due to the presence of constraints in this system. And this is what why we believe that those models aren't generic many body systems. Due to the presence of constraints, they due to the interplay of constraints and disorder, there are certain interactions which appear in those systems, and maybe that's why they behave in such a way. And that's why we find the localization when we go to larger and larger system sizes in those models. Let me skip this slide. So this brings one to another question. So what's the best we could hope for? And the best we could hope for in such analysis of a crossover between localized and delocalized regions, maybe we can learn something considering the Anderson transition on random regular graphs. This problem, on one hand, has a crossover which quite strongly resembles the crossover between ergodic and many-body localized phases, which I have shown before. However, the problem it is known what is the critical disorder strength for the transition between delocalized and localized regions, and it can be found by certain analytical methods which are particular to the random regular graphs. And if one analyzes the crossover between delocalized and localized regimes on those random regular graphs using these disorder strengths WT and W star, one finds that the extrapolation of the crossing point quite nicely matches the position of the transition up to a few percent. One also finds that finds the regime in which the WT is scaling linearly with system size, just as for the XXZ model. However, one also finds a deviation from this scaling at larger system sizes. And this deviation suggests that everything in the infinite system size shrinks, crossover shrinks to a point that we have a step function behavior with a step at the critical disorder strength. So this is let's say the best one could hope for a problem of many body localization. Yes.
So when you look at Anderson transition, isn't the model non-interacting so that you can go to large number of problems?
Yes. So this is non-interacting problem. So that's why it is easy and the critical disorder strength is known. However, this is Anderson model on random regular graphs, and random regular graphs can be thought of as having an infinite dimension, which roughly means that the diameter of the graph is scaling logarithmically with the number of the sides, and that's why this problem has this phenomenology. And the number of vertices on the graph which I am considering is actually exponential, and the system sizes I am talking about are linked to the number of vertices and the dimensionality of the model by these 2 to the L. So the same as for interacting problem. So
you are effectively solving non-interactive problem, but the dimension for that is exponentially large.
Yes, and the scaling properties are the properties in L rather than in N. So that's why it is kind of similar to MBL. But I'm just claiming that the analysis with those two disorder strengths makes sense for this model, and I'm just also indicating what are the best strongest indicators of the ergodicity breaking one could hope for by comparison to this simpler problem.
Sure.
In contrast, if one compares this crossover to crossover on Anderson problem on, let's say, 3D cubic lattice, then one finds that the crossing point is at a certain finite value of R rather than in the infinite system size at the Poisson value. And then the phenomenology is slightly different. The crossing point is barely moving and the problem is easier. In the last 4 minutes, let me talk about many-body localization in Kick-Dicing model. So the Kick-Dicing model is a flocked model specified by the flocked operator, which is a product of two operators. And Now, this operator is diagonal in Z basis, whereas this is diagonal in X basis. And I would like to use the Polfelt algorithm to calculate eigenvectors of this Hamilton, of this Floquet operator. It turns out that in order to act with such a Floquet operator on vectors, one just needs to efficiently transform from Z basis to X basis. And this can be done by means of fast Hadamard transform, which is a generalization of fast Fourier transform. I'm just considering vector in Z basis, acting with this diagonal operator, doing fast Hadamard transform to X basis, in which this operator acts trivially as a diagonal matrix, and then I'm switching back to Z basis. In that way, I can efficiently multiply vectors by this Floquet operator. This motor has disorder, which enters via this HJ term. And since it is a Floquet model, I have parameter G, which specifies the strength of disorder. And the strong disorder limit is when G is getting small, and I am not changing the amplitude of this HJ. This model was studied before in the context of MBL. And I am calculating eigenstates with Polfelt of this model up to system size L equal to 20. And again, getting similar behavior of the gap ratio and similar behavior in the other observables. And what is interesting is that if I look at the properties of the crossover using the disorder strengths I have described, I see very much phenomenology which is similar to XXZ model for WT linear scaling. However, I see a deviation from this linear scaling, suggesting that there might be a localization transition. If I consider not only the gap ratio, but also other quantities, and I look at the crossing points, let's say in risk-calibrated entanglement entropy or the quantum mutual information, I see that all of those probes, upon extrapolation with small order polynomials in 1 over L, seem to indicate similar value of the critical disorder strength. Which in conjunction with this deviation of the WT from linear scaling suggests that this model might be many-body localized. So, another premise which suggests that this model is more localized or finite size effects are slightly smaller than for XXZ is that if one extrapolates the linear scaling, and the crossing point behavior, one gets the length scale, which is 28 lattice size, in contrast to 50 for XXZ, which using that, we can hope that we are closer to the asymptotic regime in this model. And also, if one performs finite size scalings for this model using power law ansatz for divergence of the correlation length at the transition, which might be not true, which may be invalid for many-body localization. However, I'm just using as an assumption this ansatz and uses a substituting correction. Then one gets that the critical exponent is consistent with 2 for the larger system sizes we can get, which is consistent with Harris band. And those collapses, which are shown in here, are in the plane of the exponent nu, which describes the divergence of the correlation length and w. And the contours denote the broad minima of the of the cost functions for various quantities. especially for gap ratio, there is strong correlation between the critical disorder strength obtained the collapse and the value of the exponent nu. It is smaller for other observables, but each of the minima is of the contour for minima is consistent with the nu equal to 2 if we believe in the value 3.15 for the critical disorder strength, which is the one which is consistent with the extrapolation of the crossing point to large system size limit. Okay, so this brings me to the end. concluding, PolFET is a method which utilizes the sparse structure of matrix to get eigenstates. It has advantage of the polynomial spectral transformations have an advantage that they have quite small memory usage. Then they can be used not only for the Hermitian and real symmetric problems, but also to Floquet problems, which is not the case for, let's say, for Schütte-invert. Yeah, and then the main bottleneck is the speed of the matrix vector multiplication. Hopefully it could be improved using either in time or using different architectures. And then I have described three systems in which I can study MBL transition, and I have argued that the features of the transition in the quantizing model are pointing more strongly towards localization in the system than the features of the crossover in XXZ spin chain, which are usually considered in the context of many-body localization. And finally, let me, I also wanted to say that these problems with finite size effects has also its counterpart in the finite time behavior of observables if one consider dynamics of the systems, but this is other story. So thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much for the nice talk. If you have any questions, please, from the audience. In Zoom, if you have question in Zoom, you can speak up. Okay, Fabian, please speak up.
Yes, I don't know if you can hear me correctly. Can you hear me?
Yes, yes.
Yes. Okay, thank you for a very nice talk. I have one small comment and one question. The small comment is that Schütte-invert actually does not necessarily require a large memory, right? It's just because we have been stupid and we have been using LU decomposition, which is the simplest. So in principle, you can also do an iterative solutions, and the memory requirements are exactly the same, if not less than PolFET. But the convergence is another issue. So the question is whether you could find, in that case, good preconditioners to have a better scaling for your iterative. So I think it would be worth, I think, investigating that path of doing the Schütte-invert more cleverly. The second one is a question about physics, precisely on that slide. So you try to extrapolate several critical value for disorder for several MBL problems, but is there any theoretical foundation for this scaling, or is it mostly phenomenological? Why should the critical disorder scale as L? Actually, if you think in terms of second order first condition, it's not that scaling, right? You see what I mean?
Yeah. So this is purely phenomenological. But as two like arguments in favor of that, I have this behavior for random regular graphs, which may be relevant or may not be relevant, of course. The another fact is, like, if you consider this scaling form, then one finds that the crossing point. So if one does not have the subleading correction, then there is no shift of the crossing point.
Point should go like. Well, the crossing point is some WC of L, right? So it should scale also as as L one over nu.
No,
L one minus one over nu.
I believe that. I don't have. So if one assumes this form, then one sees that the crossing point actually scales like one over nu plus y.
Yes, if this is a subleading correction, then it's different, yes.
Yeah, but then if one takes y equal to infinity, then one finds that there is no crossing point shift associated with this, with only this term. So I would say that the phenomenology of the crossing point, like one could argue that it is just it is consistent with interplay of those two features, the universal this function and the subleading correction. But of course I have no.
Assuming there's no subleading correction, which could well be, then if you just look at that function, then am I saying something stupid that the critical strength is precisely because f, looking at the argument of f, it should scale as L to the whatever 1 minus over nu. I'm not, no, am I saying something wrong?
I don't think so. So it does if one has so that scaling ansatz is well suited for such data as in here. If there is no flow of the crossing point, but I'm trying to come up with an argument. But like if one has L1, a certain value of like L1, put in here an L1 and another L2, yes, and then uses a linear expansion around the critical point for this function, which can be done in the just in the vicinity of the critical point, then one will find that the L1 is equal to L. This is simple exercise. I'm trying to put L1 in here, another equation for L equal to 2, and I'm trying to compare one to second one, and I think that I will find that W1 is equal to W2. And I will find no shift of the crossing point, unless I have subleading correction, and then the subleading and then the interplay of this exponent with this exponent gives me the shift of the critical point. But still, this is nothing. This is just a claim about the ansatz, whether the physics is has something to do with such ansatz or not. And recently, it is argued that it doesn't.
I agree.
It's well possible. I'm just in this slide. I'm just claiming that there is if one uses these ansatz, then there is probably not so much problem with numerical data. But whether nu is 2